Talks books. In the Tsar's Russia, well, it was just typical. A duke, a king, a tsar, they picked their girlfriends, their mistresses from the ballet. Well, this is the story, the true story of Little Kay, who was the mistress of the last Tsar of Russia. The book is called The True Memoirs of Little Kay. It's written by my guest, Adrian Sharp. It's published by Farah Strauss Giroux. And welcome, Adrian.
Thank you.
And Little Kay is really Matilda Karasinska.
Karasinska.
And her father was also a dancer in the ballet and really one of the ballet masters. And she had started as a little girl. And then when she is around 17, she starts being watched. She's short, but she is powerful.
She actually started at this school a little younger than most of the girls start because she was driving her father crazy at home, constantly trying on costumes and posing and doing postures and making up dances. And he finally took her into the ballet master and he said, "What am I going to do with her? She's begging me to go to the theater." Mm-hmm. I bring her to the theater to see a show. She comes home, she's so excited. She stays up all night. She's dancing all over the living room. What am I going to do with her? And the ballet master said, "All right, bring her to the school 2 years early." He took a look at her, he saw her dance. And so she came in and she joined the school. And that's why she was so young, 17, when she met Nicholas at her graduation performance dinner.
And what's interesting is she says about herself, "I had short legs." She was not the typical ethereal ballerina that one thinks of. She was short and stocky and strong on her feet.
I think she would hate to have been called stocky, but she kind of was.
Yeah.
The bodies of dancers at that time in the 1800s and 1700s were not yet those tall, slim, balancing girls that we're used to now. Mm-hmm. A lot of the Italian ballerinas were a little stocky and they were shorter. And there was a lot of small leg work and a lot of quick turning that went on. And so those bodies did those kind of movements better. So she fit in with that older style of ballerina. Her legs were a little too short, so she had to make costumes to cover up that flaw. She'd have them with long kind of skirts and at a waistline that was particularly attractive so that it would conceal that problem that she had.
Yeah.
She also had kind of flat feet, too.
Which is unusual.
It is. Not usual.
But she was shrewd enough to know how to compensate for all of those parts of her body. Shrewd enough that when the Tsar introduces her to his young son, Nicholas, she knows how to now put herself in position to bump into him.
She almost stalked him. She walked through the streets for months on end after the first time they met. She would walk back and forth in front of the palace, hoping to see him having a smoke out on the balcony. She would beg her Russian coachman from the parents so that she could go out on the afternoon promenade, which was when all of Petersburg in the late afternoon mm-hmm. would go up and down the boulevards, nodding to each other and visiting, hoping to meet him. She would go to the races on Sunday, hoping to meet him. She did almost everything she could to engineer another meeting in which she could flirt with or impress him. She fell in love with him so quickly, with one of those schoolgirl type crushes. Yeah. It was quite fierce.
And she finally does. How does she do it?
It ends up happening in the summer at the summer encampment where the Russian regiments would join to do maneuvers. And it's a much more relaxed atmosphere there. And there was a little theater built near the encampment, and the Tsar would have theater actors and dancers take a special train in from Petersburg to perform for them in the evening after maneuvers. And they would visit during rehearsals, and between each piece that was performed that evening on the stage, the Tsar, the Grand Dukes, Nicholas would come onto the stage and chat. And I think in that more relaxed atmosphere is where she was able to make some of her strongest allies, including the Grand Duke Vladimir Alexandrovich, who was able to help her many times later in her career. Mm-hmm. And she was able to make inroads with the Tsar, well, the Tsar's son, Tsarevich at that time. And he said, I'm going to come collect you in my troika and take you for a ride after tonight's performance. And they had a mad dash through the darkened village and parade grounds. And they stayed out all night long. And that was the beginning of their real romance.
Yeah. But even then, he tells her that he has seen Alexei at a wedding. And he's sort of more smitten in the beginning with this Alexei and treats little Kay like just another dancer.
He fell in love with Alex when he was very young. This is Alex of Hesse, who became Empress Alexandra. She would visit because her older sister married one of the Grand Dukes. And they met at a few parties. And they fell in love very young. They etched their initials in the window of one of the palaces. He gave her a diamond pin, which she later returned to him, saying she didn't feel it was right of her to have taken that. And they carried on a written correspondence and would visit periodically. And I think he was quite drawn to that melancholy side of Alex. She lost her mother and her sister when she was a very little girl. And I think he felt very protective of her and very drawn to that sadness in her, possibly because of his own early sadness when his grandfather was assassinated in the street. And so... But I think he kind of gave up hope that that romance would ever turn into a marriage because she did not want to convert. And the Empress of Russia has to be Russian Orthodox, and she was loath to let go of her Lutheranism. So it was right at that period where she refused him yet again that he consummated his relationship with Matilda and set her up in a house.
And Matilda kept saying, I know there is a ring that will show I had royalty in my background. I am not just a ballerina to be someone's mistress. And she cannot find it. And all she wants to do is prove it to Nicholas. This is who I really am. You can marry me. Forget it. It isn't going to happen.
I'm not sure she'd have been royal enough anyway, even if she'd found a ring. And even with I'm not even sure how much I believe the story that she so fervently believed in, truly as a real-life character, that she had this royal blood, the account somewhere in the past.
Now, Nicholas does buy her a house or a villa. Her father and mother are against this.
Her father can see what Matilda can't see, that her idol is going to be short and that the Tsarevich is going to be Tsar and the Tsar has to marry a princess and there's no way he's going to marry a dancer no matter what we do in our ballets, you know, in the theater. Yeah. And I think Matilda kind of thought maybe it could be like a storybook, like in one of the ballets. Yeah. Her father, being a dad, could see that that was not going to happen and that his daughter was going to basically spoil herself for any... a marriage to a good Catholic Polish man of their social circle.
Yeah.
But all she wanted was her happiness, and she just grabbed it with two hands. And
she goes along, she takes the house, and the Tsar dies, and Nicholas is now the new Tsar. And she, in a way, is put in the back street. She's not invited to any of the great parties. She's not invited to the coronation. She has to bide her time.
She has to bide her time, and I think she was luckier than many discarded mistresses in that Nicholas, always being a gentleman, felt guilty that he'd taken her virginity and looked out for her at the theater and looked out for her in life as well by giving her his cousin, the Grand Duke Sergei Mikhailovich, to be her new protector and to take care of her.
Yeah.
And he is the one who bought her a summer house. He is the one who helped fund the running of her household. He is the one who helped with the negotiations and put up some of the money to buy the house that Nicholas gave her, because he didn't even have enough money at the time to do that for her. And more importantly, he served as go-between Matilda and the Tsar for the rest of his life, ferrying messages back and forth.
He was a sweet man.
He was devoted to her, and she became like a common law wife for him, although he wouldn't marry her, because to marry her would mean to give up titles, to give up income, possibly to be exiled, because the Tsar did this to a number of imperial men who made marriages to common women. Mm-hmm. So he wasn't willing to give that up, but within the realm of what he could do, he did it.
And he also protected her role in the ballet, because in comes the Italians, in comes the French ballerinas, and wait a minute, we're the Russians.
Russian ballet really reached its zenith under Alexander III and Nicholas II because of the great interest in the ballet and because the Russian dancers were now starting to learn all the tricks of the Italians and the French. And so it was Matilda, really, who did Russian ballet a great favor by being, you know, so arrogant and desiring center stage so much that she asked the Tsar to get those other dancers out of the theater and off the stage and let the Russian dancers now have all that space.
Yes. And Nicholas, Tsar Nicholas and Alexei begin to have children, one daughter after another.
I read that the Tsar was so upset after the birth of the fourth daughter that he, before he could even face his wife, he had to go walk the grounds of the palace park just to pull himself together because he wanted an heir so badly.
Yeah. And he does, as she discovers that she is pregnant, and we're not sure if it's his, she is sure it's his child. One reads it and says, wait a minute, maybe it was Sergei's. And she produces a son, but his wife, Alexei, finally has a son. She also has somebody called Rasputin. And what a difference that made in their lives, and maybe that still be in, the Romanovs would still be in power.
It's true. The tragedy of that hemophilia that their son, Alexei, suffered from had an enormous effect beyond just the inner circle of the family. Nicholas and Alexander really wanted to keep the illness private, and they saw Rasputin as a private advisor and someone who could help with his magical, still unexplained powers of healing, could stop the almost fatal bleeding episodes that their son would endure. But unfortunately, Rasputin was kind of a theatrical figure himself.
Oh, I would.
And he loved to costume himself, and he loved to wield power, and he loved to grant favors, and he loved to talk and to drink and to visit brothels and to make a spectacle of himself all over the city. So the man who could have been just a private healer became a big public nuisance and a political liability.
But Alexei does not give him up. As a matter of fact, I never knew about each and every one of her children at the end, when they were murdered, all had around their neck a medallion that had one side was Rasputin, the other was something about him.
That's right. She believed in him to the very end, and even after he was murdered and she had him buried on the property of the palace grounds, and then after the revolution, his body was dug up and burned.
Yeah.
She still believed in him and believed he was watching out for them from on high. And on their trip out to Siberia, they actually passed by the house where he was born. And she called all the girls and her son out to the bridge to take a look at Rasputin's house as they went by.
By the way, until I read your book, I did not know how Rasputin really died and was murdered. I mean, they couldn't make the man die.
It's not certain whether, like, was the doctor so nervous that he put the wrong amount of